Hello, everybody, and welcome to episode 4 of Death by Digital Digs. Today, we're going to tackle a larger topic. We're going to talk about the entire history of one record label, and that is called Bonsai Records from Montreal, Canada. Let's check it out. Bonsai Records was founded in 1984 by Michel Meese. Michel ran a record store in Montreal, Canada called Rock and Stock, which was apparently a pretty amazing store for its time, focusing on heavy metal. He saw that there was kind of a huge upswing of people who were listening to heavy metal and not a lot of opportunities for them to be getting it here in Canada. So what he did was he founded this label mainly as a distribution agent at first. And if you think about a traditional record label would sign a band, pay for their studio time, and then press their records and help, I guess, push that band to, a larger audience. He did that, but only in Canada, and he wasn't necessarily signing bands. He was taking a lot of the bands that were already on Neat, Noise International Records, Roadrunner, and of course Megaforce, and approaching those labels and seeing if he could work with PolyGram Records and distribute it to Canadian record stores. The home base, of course, was at his own record store in Montreal, and a lot of stuff was sent out from that spot as well as from PolyGram. The first release on Bonsai was At War With Satan, which is an incredible way to kick off your label. Then they went right on to Metallica's Kill 'Em All, which I'm going to show you that I have two different pressings of the Kill 'Em All Bonsai record with different labels, which we're going to get into shortly with label variations. And then they released Anthrax's Fistful of Metal, which also had a double release with two different labels, which I'll show you shortly as well. Now let's talk about the look of this label. The logo always featured two samurai warriors fighting one another, as you can see on my t-shirt. And every single album, and I'm just gonna show you the Metallica's Kill 'Em All, had either black and red, or here's another copy of Kill 'Em All, the white and red label. Some bands like Metallica, which had a repress, as well as, let's say, Fistful of Metal by Anthrax, there would be two different label versions of it because, well, obviously the band did so well, it prompted them to do an eventual re-release. So not every single album on this label has two label variations, just some of the more sought after ones, as you can see here. One thing that was very similar between all of them, they would all start by saying this side and that side. That side was obviously side B, which had the Bonsai logo on it, the red, black, and white logo. And then the standard A side always had the track listing and any other relevant information. A little over a dozen releases also had a really neat logo here, which is called the Speed Metal logo. Sometimes it was featured on the back cover like this, and I'm just gonna quickly grab Destruction's Infernal Overkill here, and as you can see, the Speed Metal logo is on the bottom. This was a way of just kind of separating some of the more aggressive releases from traditional thrash stuff. It didn't always line up. There were a few oddballs that still had that Speed Metal logo on it, and obviously ripping albums like Ride the Lightning did not have that on it, but it was a bit of a visual identifier. And again, I want to say 12 to 14 of these exist between their whole label output. Almost every single album on Bonsai had an identical cover to its European or American counterpart, with the exception of a few albums, which had either an alternative cover or, let's say, a censored cover, just in hopes of getting it out to more people. I'm not saying this label was family friendly, but it did make a few amendments in order to get things into traditional record stores across Canada. A few predominant releases in my collection include Possessed's Seven Churches, which I think is one of the greatest thrash metal albums of all time, obviously gearing towards a bit more death metal on the ends of things. And again, no matter how ripping this album is, as you can see, it does not have that Speed Metal logo on it. Another amazing one in my collection is Show No Mercy by Slayer, and I also have the Bonsai pressing of Haunting the Chapel. These are obviously very sought after pieces, but just ripping tunes nonetheless. Another notable record on Bonsai is Bathory's self-titled with the red logo on the front. This one can catch up to $500 online and is truly a very, very rare piece. Another really cool recording is the Bonsai Axe Sampler. As you can see here, Metallica and Raven, Slayer, Venom, obviously pushing some of the more heavier stuff that was on this label. It's a double LP, so it includes a bonus 12-inch with a couple tracks on it. A lot of the inner sleeves for these records were identical to either their European or their American counterparts. An example being Metallica's Kill 'Em All, the insert is almost identical to the Megaforce first pressing of that. Select Records eventually included this kind of merchandise sheet, which only talks about their full lengths and their mini albums, as well as the 12 inches. There's some nice photographs along the side as well. It's a bit of a hard thing to find. Every time I find one of these, I keep it nowadays because I want to make sure that every one of my records has at least one of these on the inside. So I think a lot of people consider their record to be complete when it has the inner sleeve, as well as this insert and the outer sleeve and, of course, record. What is most peculiar about the label is there's no known test pressings. So this makes me wonder whether the mother plates were coming from the United States and we were just dubbing off of, I guess, like second pressings of things, or let's say something came from Roadrunner, we would borrow their mother plates in order to press our own records here. Nobody knows for sure, though the matrix etchings are obviously unique to the records themselves here in Canada, as they all possess their own identifiers. I want to say there's gotta be some plate out there that exists or a test pressing that exists, but who knows? And arguably the most rare piece on all of Bonsai Records is something that was released in conjunction with Megaforce. So it was a bunch of titles of records that were borrowed from Megaforce as the Canadian distributor here in Canada. And it had four tracks on it, two by Anthrax, one by Exciter, and one by Metallica. It had the red and black logo on one side, and the other side it had this white and red text on it. This is actually known to be the most scarce record to find on the entire label. I believe that there are between 1 and 300 copies that exist worldwide. And even though that Bathory record catches more money because there's more people that are after it, this is the one that was produced with the most few copies. As with a lot of bands moving to major labels, Bonsai stopped getting some of the bigger bands on their label when, let's say Metallica, who was originally on Megaforce Records in the States, and then they had a bunch of subsidiaries around the world that helped distribute and release their records. Once they moved on to Warner, and Warner had a subsidiary called Elektra Records, they were then distributed within Canada through Warner's Elektra label. So therefore, when Master of Puppets came out as an example, or even when the second and third press of Ride the Lightning came out, and Ride the Lightning was then reissued on Elektra, they were no longer able to be releasing things on Bonsai. Same thing happened with bands like Slayer and Anthrax, so eventually the label started to fizzle out. I believe the last record that was released on Bonsai came out in 1989, and at that point I believe the label was already experiencing some legal trouble. PolyGram continued to distribute stuff for a few more years within Canada, as they still had the rights to it and there was still a back catalog. So there was a lot of things that weren't necessarily in print, but had already been pressed. So they were still able to be picked up by distributors. I truly believe this is one of the most important labels to come out of Canada, especially for heavy metal history. But there is some mystery around the end of this label's tenure. Nobody knows for sure. I've heard rumors that Michel even did jail time, but I do know for a fact that the label, as well as his record store, was shut down in the late 90s because of a raid on bootleg CDs. One thing that should be pointed out about collecting Bonsai is you're kind of stuck to two formats. They never ventured into CDs. So though I'm showing records today, there's also a collectible cassette market. For those, I do not believe that there is a second pressing of any cassette, though I'm sure somebody might correct me if I'm wrong. Similar titles that are collectible on record are also collectible on cassette, though cassette also has a few of its own outliers. Thank you very much for tuning in to this rather lengthy episode on Bonsai Records. It is a label that means a lot to me. Obviously, as a Canadian metalhead, I was always looking for Bonsai titles as I was getting into record collecting 15, 20 years ago. I have about 40 in my collection, but I am not a completist. I'm only going to collect the ones that mean something to me and are albums that I like. Do you have any interesting Bonsai records? Do you have any information about Bonsai records that maybe I don't know about? Please post it in the comments. And thank you very much for checking out our fourth episode of Death by Digital Digs. And do not forget to subscribe, as many more will be coming out shortly. Thank you very much.